Do you know how and exactly where Mechazilla will grab SpaceX's Starships and Super Heavy boosters? What's the Bezos versus Musk lawsuit outcome, and what does it mean for SpaceX's future? Did you watch Crew 2 return, and when will Crew 3 finally launch? And what's the latest on the James Webb Space Telescope, and what will it be able to explore for us? Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. SpaceX is focusing all their efforts at Starbase on getting the orbital launch mount, the integration tower, and the orbital fuel farm ready, and at the same time they are replacing Raptor engines on Booster 4 for the upcoming proof tests and static fires. And in preparation for all this, SpaceX is changing its toolset on site. The old multicolor double boom Liebherr LR11350 crane, which achieved the first full stack of a Super Heavy booster and a Starship, is not needed anymore. Instead, SpaceX has ordered a new Liebherr LR11000 crane, including a fancy company branding. This likely means that it'll stay for a while. It's accompanying Bucky, SpaceX's yellow LR11000 crane, which has recently been moved to the construction site to assist with White Bay construction, and there's a reason for all this. This crane's boom height is not enough to stack a Starship on top of a Super Heavy booster, so SpaceX is switching from cranes to something else. And it's kind of obvious as to what they're shifting over to. Mechazilla is nearing completion, and since one of its tasks besides catching rockets will be lifting, this is the replacement for Frankencrane. SpaceX has recently added a few new things to the chopsticks. These triangular pieces, for example. They are for stabilization, and they'll play a big part in stacking and securing the rockets after the catch. To understand how exactly these chopsticks work, we'll have to take a look at Ship 20, the latest Starship prototype and hopefully the one to attempt a first orbital launch. So this is Ship 20's nose section with the heat shield attached. And if you pay close attention, you'll notice some blank spots still left. All the way up on the nose we have the load spreader attachment points, big clunky hooks that circle the nose. This likely isn't a final solution, as it makes constructing the nose cone difficult. But there are more spots missing tiles. Can you spot them? Right. One directly under the forward flap and one a bit further down. Tiny and at first barely visible. If we zoom in closer, we can easily see the load point integrated into the hull. The one further down looks precisely like this. Looking at the chopsticks again shows that the distance between the top of the chopsticks and the very end of the stabilizers is about the same as the distance between the two load points on the Starship nose. Ove has made a spot-on animation for us again, and this is how it'll play together with the chopsticks. The vertical stabilizers will move inwards, grabbing the Starship at the lower load point, giving the chopsticks a second attachment point. This way, the Starship won't be able to swing in any direction anymore as soon as the chopsticks have attached themselves to the hull. And it'll work the same way on the boosters too. This is Booster 4, as seen through Lewis's camera, and this is where the two load points can be found on the booster. Same distance from each other and same purpose. Lunar Caveman made a great schematic to show the exact positioning on a booster. Here you can see the assembly attached to Booster 4. The diagram is made to scale, and the vertical stabilizers are rotated inwards and locked into the side sockets on the booster. Again, this will work in precisely the same way on the ship. It'll enable SpaceX to replace Frankencrane for any stacking operations in the future, and it will fix the Starships in place after they've been caught out of mid-air by the chopsticks. Lunar Caveman, I'm looking forward to seeing you at the upcoming meetup in Titusville. And to be able to lift the chopsticks up and down, SpaceX workers have been busy getting the pulley system attached to the drawworks on the base of the tower over the past few days. The cable will run from the drawworks on the tower's base, over the top and through a pulley block, back down on the other side and to the pulley block on the chopsticks. From there, it'll go up again through a second pulley block and down on the backside to a dead-end wire spool. This way, the drawworks directly connect to the chopsticks, and the dead-end spool can tighten the wires as needed. Next up, we'll talk about a special system that would greatly help SpaceX in catching a Starship, Blue Origin suing SpaceX, Crew 2 landing and Crew 3 being pushed out again, and final preparations for the James Webb Space Telescope before its launch. So stay tuned, it's worth it. The Y family needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe, and share it with your friends on Twitter or Facebook to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Looking for a more direct way of support? Become a Patreon or YouTube member by clicking the join button right under the video and get some awesome perks. Gain access to our Discord server where you can meet me and the rest of the community or get a completely ad-free release of each and every episode provided just for channel members. Or do you know about the Y Warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt, hoodie or cap and look as awesome as you feel. We also have a brand new sub-channel called Y+. More Y, more Starbase and more space enthusiasm. The link is in the description, subscribe and ring the bell. There's one more aspect about the chopstick system that I'd like to talk about before moving on to the next subject. It's speculative, and it's unknown if SpaceX will make use of it, so take it with a grain of salt, active heave compensation. In a nutshell, active heave compensation is a system integrated into oil rig drawworks like SpaceX decided to use on their orbital launch integration tower to move the chopsticks. Here you can see a live demonstration of how precise such a large drawworks winch can move. On ships and oil rigs, it's used to compensate for the boat's movement, to be able to position the load at the end precisely in the water without it moving up and down. It's a computerized system, and the drawworks installed by SpaceX indeed is capable of winch-based active heave compensation. Catching a Starship will need absolute precision from both the ship itself and the chopsticks. Connecting the software of the active heave compensation with the ship's location would enable the chopsticks to move into precisely the right spot with extremely fine and accurate adjustment. These oil rig drawworks basically specialize in quick directional change and exact movement. What do you think? Would it be smart and will SpaceX use such an active heave compensation system for their chopstick assembly? As always, tell me in the comments. Bezos versus Musk. In a nutshell, Jeff Bezos' Blue Origin sued NASA over a $2.9 billion contract given by NASA to Elon Musk's SpaceX for creating a human landing system for the moon. The proposed system in question is this, the National Team Concept. Led by Blue Origin with help from Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman and Draper, it was supposed to be the next big thing for Blue Origin. A lunar lander to deliver the next astronauts to the lunar surface under the Artemis program. After being rejected by NASA in April of this year, Bezos and his company filed a lawsuit against NASA. Back in September, Musk already made it very clear to the public what his opinion about the lawsuit was.
I think he should put more of his energy into getting to orbit than lawsuits. You cannot sue your way to the moon.
Now, the US Court of Federal Claims has ruled against Blue Origin with federal judge Richard Hertling siding with the defense in his ruling. What this means for SpaceX is pretty straightforward. NASA's $2.9 billion will flow into this, the SpaceX Lunar Starship. Capable of sending more payloads and astronauts to the moon than ever before, and the right tool for NASA and others to establish a permanent settlement on the moon. And Musk had a very direct response to the announcement on Twitter as well. You have been judged. Good news for Team NASA and SpaceX and for everyone who wants to see the team continue their work undisturbed. Crew 2 and Crew 3 update. On we go with another update from Crew 2 and 3. Crew 2 has finally landed. Almost 6 months have passed since April 23rd and since Crew 2 has launched from Kennedy Space Center. Now it's time to rotate the shift and make room for the next 4 lucky astronauts to venture to space. Crew 2 has returned home, and as always, everything went smoothly. Undocking, deorbiting, re-entry and splashdown. Thanks for flying SpaceX. High winds unfavorable for recovery near the splashdown zone in the Gulf of Mexico had previously pushed the planned return from Monday to today. Thomas Peskett, mission specialist. Akihiko Hoshida, mission specialist. Megan MacArthur, pilot, and Shane Kimbrough, Crew 2 commander. Make way for Raja Chari, Tom Marshburn, Kayla Barron, and Matthias Malva. Delayed from October 31st to November 3rd to November 7th to November 9th, it is currently set to launch from Kennedy Space Center on November 10th. at 9.03 p.m. Eastern Time. Although I would personally have no problem for the launch to be delayed even further due to my planned trip to Florida only a few days later, I am also very excited to finally see the mission launch towards the International Space Station. Unfortunately, at this time, it's doubtful that I will be doing a live stream of the launch, as it will be in the middle of the night for us here in Europe. Good luck to NASA, SpaceX, and the Crew 3 astronauts. Crew Dragon is now regularly delivering astronauts to the ISS, an incredible accomplishment by everyone involved. James Webb launch prep. That rhymed! The James Webb Space Telescope, in the making since 1996, is finally getting ready for its launch. Only during the past year, the team has completed the observatory environmental testing, the final deployment of JWST, they stowed it into its launch configuration, they completed the final test between the spacecraft and the Mission Operations Center in Baltimore, Maryland, shipped the observatory to the launch site, and recently they completed the final mission rehearsal. Considering how important the mission is and how long it took to prepare the next big space observatory for its launch, there's tremendous pressure on Arianespace and the Ariane 5 rocket prepared for the mission. After arriving at the European spaceport in French Guiana on October 12th, the observatory is now undergoing final launch preparations and is slated to launch on December 18th. These are the final meters JWST will do on the ground. With 20 countries participating in development and construction and $9.7 billion of lifetime cost for the mission and $8.8 billion of this only going into development and construction, James Webb has already made it into the books even before the launch. The 29 days following liftoff will be an exciting but harrowing time. Thousands of parts must work correctly in sequence to unfold Webb and put it in its final configuration, all while it flies through the expanse of space alone to a destination nearly 1 million miles away. Engineers on the ground will remotely orchestrate a complex sequence of deployment in these hours and days immediately after the launch. As the largest and most complex telescope ever sent into space, the James Webb Space Telescope is a technological marvel. If it all works out, it'll make far more than a footnote in humanity's story of exploring the cosmos. It'll be powerful enough to look at the light reflected by planets in distant solar systems, capable of giving us information about the composition of exoplanet atmospheres, possibly being the first instrument to actually give us the ability to see so-called life indicators. Elements that can only exist in specific quantities if life exists inside that planet's atmosphere. Here's to the entire development and manufacturing team of the James Webb Space Telescope. Fingers crossed for the launch. Today's episode is brought to you by the Rich Wallet. It's light, sleek, and industrial. It doesn't fold or awkwardly bulge in your back pocket, and it seriously changed my whole pocket situation. I got sponsored by them back in September of last year. It holds up to 12 cards plus room for cash. There's over 30 colors and styles, including carbon fiber and burnt titanium. It has 30,000 five-star reviews. It's so durable, it comes with a lifetime warranty. You can buy it and carry it for the rest of your life, and the Rich team is so confident that you'll like it that they'll let you test drive it for 45 days. You can send it back for a full refund if you don't love it. Back then, I tested it and loved it from the first moment on. All my thoughts of missing my old wallet were gone after 10 minutes of using it. And guess what? I still use it and I still love it, and after a year of constantly carrying it around, it still looks brand new. That speaks for itself. To make the most awesome wallet switch of your life and at the same time support What About It, go to rich.com/felix, that's rich.com/felix, and use the code Felix to get 10% off today with the free worldwide shipping and returns. Change your pocket situation with Rich. Links in the description. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Arve Svenning, John Craig, Gregory Lewis, Oleg Platonenko, and many others. You rock so incredibly much. It is an honor to have you on board and to be supported by so many. Make sure to hop on our supporter exclusive Discord to join more than 1,000 spaceflight enthusiasts and to give me a chance to thank you in person. Today's team shoutout goes to the Y plus QC team. Ryer, Sam, MaxQ, Nick, Quango. You're creating something truly spectacular on the Y plus sub channel, and it's getting better with each and every succeeding release. I'm damn proud to have you with us. Thank you. You guys rock. Par, how, goddamn. LR, per, leap, how, leap, her. Herr, it's German. Leaper 11R. Instead, SpaceX has ordered a new Leap. Leaper 11R. 11,000. No!